Hi everybody, so like Christina said, my name is Daniel. Today we're going to be talking about RethinkDB, Tornado, the Python web framework, and a little bit about asynchronous frameworks in general. But like Christina said, my name is Daniel. I'm originally from the Seattle area. I love Python. I'm also an avid gelato eater. So if you guys know an awesome gelato place, I need to know it or else I'm just not going to be happy here in the Bay Area. So if you guys could come tell me your favorite place, that'd be great. But first, what is RethinkDB? I assume you guys are all here at the RethinkDB meetup, so you've probably maybe heard about us, at least. But RethinkDB is an open source database for building real-time web applications. It's a NoSQL database. So you put in JSON, you get JSON out. And it's distributable, so it's really easy just to add another server and keep adding to your cluster. And probably what originally attracted me to RethinkDB is that you're able to subscribe to change notifications. And so you can write a query and subscribe to any changes on that query in the future in real time. At one point or another, we all try to build a web app like Gmail or Facebook or Twitter, and it's not fun because it's just you trying to work on this thing and make something awesome that some company called Google has spent millions of dollars and many developers building. So things that help you get to this point are really attractive to me. And RethinkDB is one of those things that reduces the amount of code that you have to write to make something awesome. And it resonates with me because one of my favorite quotes is from the author of The Petit Prince, which is, "Perfection is attained not when there's nothing more to add, but when there is nothing more to remove." And just last week, there was an article on Hacker News which had something similar in the similar vein that also spoke to me, which is, to a great extent, the act of coding is one of organization. Removing things that aren't necessary, this is kind of like the mantra of RethinkDB and why, one, I'm now here as a developer evangelist for them. So moving along. Change feeds. So you can subscribe to change notifications on a database query. And so say if we had a table of users, if you want to just get all those users, you would ignore everything up until the dot changes. But if you want to know about everything that happens to that table, all you have to do is add dot changes to it. And what happens is you'll get a cursor back that never closes. And so it'll always remain open. You can keep iterating off that cursor and get all the newest information about that table. And you also get the new value of a document if it's updated, as well as the old version of what it looked like up until a moment ago. So if we have a users table and we wanted to say, well, Bob's no longer part of our users, let's delete him, up like it says up here at the top. Down at the bottom is what you would get if you were also currently listening on a change feed. And so you can see that the new value is null because we've now deleted him, but the old value is the document that used to exist there. So change feeds also don't just apply to the entire table. You can use it on your whole expanded query. So here we're getting a list of players in descending order by their score, and we're getting just the top three. And so we don't care about the rest of them, we just want the top three. And if those top three change, we want to know about it. And so we do a dot changes on that. And now we can keep our scoreboard up to date, up to the moment. And so the next part of this talk is like, why Tornado, right? Well, I like Python. And the thing about Python right now is that it's not mature enough. It's getting there. And by the end of this year, because there's some changes coming to Python, it's not ready for like real asynchronous frameworks. There's a couple things like Tornado which make it easy though, and that's why I wanted to make it the focus of this talk. So asynchronous web frameworks, just for those who don't know, is kind of like event-driven programming. You're listening on a certain thing, and you're not blocking other things that are also happening in terms of I/O. And it's well suited for the real-time web, and it's great friends with RethinkDB. So you can make queries asynchronously and consume multiple change feeds at the same time without blocking. So you can have multiple real-time streams moving into your app and updating various UI elements really easily. And I'm sure all of you are like, but Daniel, there's this thing called the GIL, and it's in your way, because if you're familiar with Python, you know something called the global interpreter lock. When I first think of GIL, I've played a lot of games that start with Final Fantasy, so that's the first thing I think of. But just for review, the global interpreter lock basically ensures that only one thread runs an interpreter at a single time. Parallel execution is forbidden. So it's things like, people might be more familiar with Node.js. You're like, oh, well, that's in the back of my mind. It just happens automatically. But in Python, it's like a second-rate citizen, unfortunately, at this moment. So you kind of have to worry about these things called ticks. And about every 100 ticks, which is a very low level operation in Python, it checks to say, hey, can I let go of this lock? And can I give it to a different thread so it can do what it's trying to compute at the same time? This guy is named David Beasley, and in my opinion, he's kind of like the cool uncle of Python. And every year, there's a conference called PyCon, which is amazing. You should go to it. But he gives an amazing talk every year, and I was there this past one in Montreal, and he gave one on none other than asynchronous kind of frameworking in Python. But about 5 years ago, he wrote some code to kind of demonstrate what it looks like to be locked by the global interpreter lock. And so this is just some really simple Python code. So we have this countdown function, and we're going to count down from a gajillion. And he divides that number to the four other threads. And he says, OK, run. And so what happens, all of those threads take that code and run it. But you don't know what that really looks like, like which thread is running at what given time. And so he visualized it. And you can go look at the original article. I have the URL down here, and I'll give the slides out at the end of this. But you can see here that each row here is a different thread. And the green chunk is when that thread is actually running. And you can see right away that it's not really distributed uniformly. The first thread finishes way early, and the other three are kind of like chunking along at their own other pace. So this is four threads running on one core, if you could imagine. So in the next iteration, same code, but this time on four cores. And this is what it looks like. So you can see it's a lot more distributed. And you might be asking, well, why is this important? And the thing is that when you're writing something like an asynchronous framework, you want to kind of think from this mentality, because the thing called time to first byte is so important. When a user opens up your website, you want it to load as fast as possible. And so you don't want what it looks like up here. You kind of want the bottom one, because the distance between when that thread is able to respond after, say, looking up a database or, you know, ensuring that the user is able to log in, you want them to get notified of the result of that as quickly as possible so they can fix their password or log in and buy things or chat with their friends. And we all know implicitly that this affects us as users. And Google did a study 6 years ago or so now that kind of proved in their kind of search-related domain that the slower you load a website, the less they're going to engage with it, right? So, and this is a big study you can Google online, but the real point is just the abstract, is that their little experiment said that, you know, less than 1% of users, they could measure how much less that they were now engaging in making searches on google.com with this, in this specific, you know, research point. So it's important for everybody, really, at all times, because we all write things for people to consume and services for people to use. So to kind of demonstrate what I'm talking about here, I wrote my own Tornado app called Rethink Tags. And what it allows people to do is go to a website, basically, and subscribe to different feeds of Instagram hashtags. So I chose corgis and gelato and puppies. And basically, they stream in real time as they're happening, and people are Instagramming their lives all over the world. So just kind of like my suggestion, if you're looking at Tornado, if you're strong in Python, but you want to have some sort of asynchronous framework that can build these kind of things, Tornado is great, but first start synchronous, because when things go wrong and you're doing things in an asynchronous fashion and you don't, the errors might not bubble up in a way that you're used to in a synchronous fashion. They might be in another thread or in a coroutine, and it's not so evident unless you catch those problems early on. And so I say start simple and then refactor later and become more complicated. So this is the easiest Tornado app you could ever write. And so at the top, we just import Tornado. We write a class that's our handler that's going to handle those web requests as they come in. And then as you can see kind of in the, oh, you don't have my cursor, in the, when we create our application variable, tornado.web.application, we also pass a map that's kind of a map between the endpoints of the URL endpoints and the class that's going to handle them. And that's it. And then we start it in the name equals equals main portion of the code. So that's just kind of get your mindset into, this is what a Tornado app kind of looks like. It gets more complicated, of course. So this, I hope you can see, yeah, is the home render, or the function that renders the home page for Rethink Tags. And you can see that there's a couple different places just on a glance that it's going to block where nothing else can happen while this is running. So if you were to open the web page and I were opening a web page and I went second, I would have to wait while the application rendered the page for you and then would render the page for me. And there's a few things here that I want to point out. Oh no, okay. The first is the connection. And so we're making a connection to RethinkDB, and then there's the post. So we're grabbing all the relevant posts because we want to start the page off with 9 images just to show you that it does work. We do have some Instagram images in the database already. And then we talk to the Instagram API down below where it says Insta API, and we also try to grab the template, the HTML file. So we're hitting the disk, we're doing all this network things, all these network things, and all the while it's inefficient. It's not the most effective way to do this. So we turn to asynchronous. And something that's completely synchronous, we start to slowly move into an asynchronous fashion. The only optimization that we've made here, you can see, is that in the purple, we've added the @tornado.web.asynchronous decorator. And now what we're doing is, the moment we receive that request, we're starting to prepare the database connection so we can start talking to it and make that query. So the moment we receive the request, we make the connection to the database, and then once the request has been parsed, and now we have all the information about what the request wants, we actually run the query and get the results back. So that's the only optimization we've made. You could go even further in this mindset. This mindset is more of like the callback nature, where after making HTTP requests, you provide a function that will be run next after it's completed. But as you know, for a lot of JavaScript people here, you know that adding callback turns into callback hell and a lot of spaghetti code. So it's not always the most, the prettiest, we'll say. That's where this next one come in. But just to show you, like I said, the tornado.web.asynchronous is kind of like the main point of this. But Tornado also recently implemented coroutines. And what coroutines look like to a Python person is basically inline callbacks. And so you get to yield everything, and it's actually quite great. So in the last example here, we can see that RethinkDB has actually written a special part of the Python driver. So it works well with the Tornado web frameworks. But you have to set the r.setLoopType to Tornado for it to work properly. And then instead of having a.tornado.web.asynchronous, you have coroutine. And then from there on out, everything that has some sort of network I/O with RethinkDB, you just yield it. And it basically says this will be a thing, but not maybe at the moment you get it. And the advantage of this over the synchronous framework is that at every yield point, it can switch to another request that's coming in and start processing for that while it's waiting for RethinkDB to respond. And therefore, it's not completely blocked at every point while rendering the page for that user. So there's definitely a huge advantage there. Next, this is all that it takes to make a web server or to make a WebSocket server using Tornado for the client side. So you would have a WebSocket that's opened in the browser and connects back to the Tornado server. And so we have a set of listeners. So a set is just an array that only allows unique objects. And on every open, we add that connection to the listeners. And we want to keep track of all these listeners because later, when we get a new change feed, we want to message all the users currently connected and notify them of the update. So so basically, when you're looking in the browser, the new corgi appears, and the new corgi appears, and another corgi appears. So the last part is, this is the code that handles all the updating to the browser. So just like the last example we saw when we're hitting the database, there's lots of yields. It's a coroutine itself. And down at the bottom, it says while forever. And basically, what's that doing is it's listening to the change feed. And so for every new change feed that comes in, it's going to go iterate through every listener and send that new Instagram post to that user. And I also, if you're not familiar with Siege, it's an Apache command line tool. And basically, what you can do is say, point it at any website or any like network resource and say, hit it with a concurrency or a number of concurrent connections, in this case 10, over 10 seconds, -t10s. And basically, these are the results using kind of a sync pattern, an async pattern, and a coroutine pattern. And so we can see, just in my dumb little example on my local MacBook Air on a solid state drive, that there's not a lot of difference, but still the coroutines perform just a little bit better than the other kind of patterns. So in that case, it is more efficient, and it's something that you should be striving to do when you're creating these kind of apps. So with that, thank you. And I encourage you to go check it out, rethinktags.dallinmiller.com. I haven't checked if it's still up. I'm kind of new to Docker, so if it's not down, or if it's down, it'll be up in a second. And you should definitely follow me on Twitter. So thank you, guys.